946. So we're going to talk a little bit about their work over the last half of a year. They've been dedicating their Friday evenings to building this robot and competing in our recent competition. And Sophia's going to start us off.
Okay, so over the middle of September, I think, we've been working on that robot. We started with designing it and working as a team to come up with the best design possible to pick up those cubes right there, which you can hold the cube up.
Yes.
That. And the goal was to get it in stacks, and this there was column that the field had. We had to stack them up to get points.
So the main priority for like the claw slash lifting mechanism was to be able to get the blocks into, as Sophia said, stacks or rows. So we had to like create that so it could accurately line them up to the little rack that it'd be placed. So the lifting mechanism is just a motor and a chain that's attached to a door slide. And as the motor engages with the chain, it raises the door slide. And we found that to be a pretty sturdy lifting mechanism. The one problem that we had with that was that the robot is, it has to be 18 by 18 at a max. So we had to, an 18 by 18 cube. We had to cut it down a little bit, but aside from that, we didn't really have any problems. And the claw is also a fairly simple design. It's just two servos with short bits of metal on them, and then some sort of tubing on the metal to hurt the blocks. That's basically the design of our claw.
For the chassis, we use Omni wheels, which have, they can roll either way. They can roll any direction, so if you put them all at like angles to the chassis, you can, if you make all of them go forwards,
on my car.
The robot actually goes forwards. So we used that. We also made a chassis with a different type of wheels called mechanical wheels, which are wheels with other smaller wheels that are on diagonal. The coating is actually the same as for the Omni wheels.
Oh my god, they're using
it. But you don't need to have the weird angles in the chassis to be able to use that. But that coating didn't end up working, so we used this.
And for the coating, we used a program called Blocks. It was by FIRST, the thing that runs the competition. And it was basically, it gave us a bunch of different like topics, and each of them had different blocks, and we took the blocks and we made the program, just put them in the correct order. And none of us knew how to program ahead of time, so we had to learn as we went. And there were definitely some problems, but the day of the competition, we figured it out, and it worked just half the time. Yeah.
That sounds about right.
Anyone else want to say anything?
I guess I'd just say another main component of this competition is the engineering notebook. The robot may seem like it's the big component, but you also get scored based on your engineering notebook, which is basically just a binder full of entries and like a drawing of what might have changed in the robot on any given day. So one pointer that was given to us is that ours didn't have enough like technical stuff, so drawings or sketches of the robot and like the problems that we're having with the code, it tended to go towards like just what was going on. So that's definitely something we need to work on next year, but I think that aside from that, we had a pretty successful notebook this year.
Does anybody have any questions?
Yeah, FIRST Robotics, they build a lot around collaboration between teams. Do you guys actively kind of share information with other teams around and in the competition?
So they hold scrimmages like halfway through the season, and a couple of our members went to the scrimmage to check out what other people were thinking and share some ideas.
Yeah, that's great.
Did some collaborating.
Another big part is there's this sort of, everybody's very generous with each other, so we were missing a few parts that we needed to pass inspection, so we could go to other teams and we could ask them for parts and they would give them to us to borrow for the competition, which was very, very helpful, and kind of competed without them. So there's this sort of air around the competition that everybody's very gracious for.
Nice.
What was the best part of the competition?
Most impressive thing about the first place robot? Like, did you see like other robots that you thought like, I wish we'd done that? Or, you know?
I think it was, this wasn't about the robot, but it was pretty impressive that they only had 2 people on their team.
Yeah.
Wow, winning.
I would also say the autonomous coding, which in the first 30 seconds of the match, the robot just runs on its own, and the top teams had really good autonomous programming, and they like the robot could get multiple lifts into the goal all on its own just using stuff that was really cool to watch.
I think I realized that a lot of the top ranking teams had like scoops instead of claws, and that didn't even occur to any of us. Mm-hmm. And it seemed to work really well for them.
And like conveyor belt.
There were other teams that like 3D printed their own parts or had all this pretty interesting stuff. There's one team, I think they got maybe 5th or 6th, and they used suction to pick up big blocks, and that was pretty cool too.
What was your biggest takeaway, like, from this experience start to finish?
I think collaborating and just working together and solving problems was really fun. Asking teams for like a specific flyer, or like it's like this whole experience that adds up and becomes something really valuable.
Okay, well, I'm going to call us to order. We wanted to have the robotics team here. And the first part of the business is reorganization. I know folks are trying to get some dinner, but I'm going to try to keep that going as well. We do have a quorum. So I'm going to jump right to 2.1 and come back to the call to order. As all of you heard me when I say local board as well, I'm trying to get right to the elected chair. I'm not running the meeting. I believe the executive committee has a slate of officers to present for all of 2.1 through 2.6, and that's included some reorganization. I forget who was going to present that, Stephen. Do you remember who was presenting that?
It was Kari.
I don't know.
We didn't decide.
I'm happy to do it, but I got to remind myself. It's in the packet, or is it in the minutes?
It's in the minutes.
Okay. Give me a moment.
It's in the unapproved minutes. That I can tell you, can help you out there, probably.
Executive Committee is recommending, and I guess I will move that Matthew DeGroote for chair, myself for vice chair, Dorothy Naylor for clerk, and Mary Hornsby for treasurer.
There was one other, which was the recommendation to establish a Washi Central
Store. And then we'd also move to establish a new committee for the SU, which would be the School Quality Committee, which has been a U32 committee. Is made up of members from other schools as well. We'd like to establish it as an SU committee.
And under 2.4, they establish the day and time of regular meetings for the Washington Central Supervisory Union is the fourth Wednesday.
Okay, so we'd also like to move to establish our regular meeting time as the fourth Wednesday of the month.
Second.
I have a second from Stephen Lowe. Are there any other nominations to any of those to that slate? Can I give enough pause?
All those in favor of the slate from 2.1 to 2.6, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Thank you very much, and congratulations to all of you to those positions. Okay, so we have 1.1 reception of guests. I'm not sure we have any guests today. But if there are any, there's maybe one. Hello. Would you like to introduce yourself? Okay, are there any agenda revisions? Board comments. We have someone here tonight who is deserving of recognition. So Stephen. So Stephen has served as the chair of the WCSU board for 4 years through what I think I can safely describe as a pretty tumultuous period, pretty tumultuous 4 years. The board working with the leadership team has accomplished a lot in those 4 years. Some of the notable achievements include the efficiency study, adopting the mission and the student learning outcomes and the implementation plan in common across the entire SU, and of course, helping us navigate through the Act 46 process. Those are just a few, some of the big ones. And Stephen has provided steady, fair, and professional leadership and facilitation throughout. He's really been kind of a rock through that whole period. So we really appreciate it. And I think Bill has something to say.
Well, Matthew took most of my words that I thought of for today, but I would echo the steadfast leadership, the fairness. I think the one thing I would add is staying to process. Stephen really believes in staying to process, and that is open for everyone. And I think he demonstrated that in the way that he facilitated the meetings, whether it be Act 46, Supervisory Union, or Executive Committee. And I learned a lot from that, and how to let the process weave its way, even if there wasn't really a seen direction, but let it ebb and flow, and let the process do it. So I really thank you for that learning for myself. So we, Matthew and I, in service of the whole board, would like to recognize your 4 years of service as the full board chair. You've got to get up. I know you don't like this stuff, but I can kid you about. But really, want to give us our heartwarming thanks.
Are there any other board comments? No, we'll move to public comments and correspondence. And we have someone here who is here to speak to a particular issue.
Yeah, hi, I was at the last B32 board meeting, if folks remember me, and I tried to do some follow-up, and I'm gonna talk really in general, not specifically about my child. I'm gonna talk really generally because I really need some answers and I feel like I haven't really gotten them. So in general, if a child and a family's needs are not being met, if a child's needs are not being met under free and appropriate education, and that family needs to remove the child from the school because of that, and kind of being told that the school board can no longer talk about that child because the child is no longer enrolled in the school, I'm having a little bit of trouble understanding that, because what the law says is that the school must provide free and appropriate education if the child is enrolled in school, but after the fact, who do I go to if I can't go to my school board, it issues a rise. This is mostly directed to you, Adrian, in response to the email you didn't answer back, and I'm here today to try and get a general answer. If a child is removed by their family for whatever reason because of not the school not providing FAPE to their child in the family's sense and feelings, doctor's feelings, everybody's, but the school staff or administration, why can't we come to the school board and talk about that, whether in executive session or in general? I just don't understand that, why this book is being closed on me, and I think it needs further discussion, and I just need to know. I asked for the actual text of school board rules that states that we can no longer talk about these children if they're being removed, but it's happening in this district. Not just my kid, many kids. I'm not going to talk about my kid because I can't do that right now. We're not in executive session. But I need to know why I can't come back to the school board and talk about it. And it's not, oh, well, we can't give you FAPE because your kid's not in the school. My kid's not in the school because my kid can be here. I'm not going to talk about that specifically, but there needs to be a way that I can go to the school board and not be shut down. Thanks.
I just want to tell you, just today, this afternoon, received four letters from four students from U32 to the Washington Central School Board asking us to reduce our dependency on biomass and on fossil fuels. I'm summarizing for you. If you'd like to see the letters, I'm more than willing to pass them around. I think they do a nice job of explaining their position and asking us to look at solar resources and other non-carbon resources. So they're including wood chips on this. They're saying no biomass as well. So I've got four of those. I know there are letters that we received for U32 in particular. So if you'd like to read those, they're well done. It's from some from Global Studies, and Jody, I think I'm missing something. What other group? And Democratic Groups class. So I'd be more invited to pass these around. They're nice letters. I just quickly skimmed them, but I thought I'd summarize them for you.
Any other public comments or correspondence? Okay, we'll move to 3.1, the consent agenda. It's going to have a motion to approve the minutes of February 21, 2018.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Yes.
Yeah, I'd like to make a couple changes.
So on 4.1, which is on page 7, the first sentence, Kari Bradley shared a brief preview of this type of monitoring report to policymakers. Does that make sense? Drawing a distinction that this is one type of monitor. They're not all of them weird absence studies. And then the second sentence, I'm sorry, did you get that?
Sorry,
it's the first sentence of 4.1. It says, shared a brief preview of, and I'd like to add this type of monitor report for policy efforts. The second sentence says, he introduced the 5-page monitor report. I think it was much longer than 5 pages, so I would just remove the number of pages.
Yeah. Any other discussion or changes to the minutes? All those in favor of approving the minutes of February 21st, 2018 as a minute, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? 4.1, Supervisory Union Goals.
So I think everyone knows that over the last couple of months, we've been working on a draft list of possible board goals for the 2018-2019 academic year. The list is behind you. Looking at it more in a little bit. The draft list is taken from various sources, the efficiency report, statutes on board responsibilities, and an analysis of topics that were reported in board and committee minutes over the last year. Our objective tonight for this agenda item is to discuss the list with the limited time we have, add anything to it that might be missing, and try to see if we can prioritize three of them for consideration. With the board's consent, the executive committee would work over April and May in consultation with the district boards to finalize wording and specifics for the three goals so that the SU and district boards could consider formally adopting them at the June carousel meeting. Ideally, the SU and district boards would adopt at least two or three goals in common to harmonize the work of our leadership and staff across the entire system next year. Obviously, district boards may have additional goals that they want to consider case by case, but we hope at least two or three to be considered in common so our work is consistent to our shared vision. So before I open the floor for suggestions and discussion, I'm going to take the chair prerogative, first time doing that, to say a few things about board goals and why I think they're important and why I think they're critical for our schools in particular right now. I'd like to, the intent here is to kind of spur some thinking about how we can craft a vision for what we want to achieve together in the next year. I work for a nonprofit organization, so we're very concerned with the mission and stories about the work that we're doing. We actually open every board meeting that we have with a story as a way of trying to connect the board to the work that we do. Probably not appropriate in every meeting that we have here as an SU, but since this is my first time doing this, I thought I'd try it out, and a few things I'd like to say will get said. I didn't write it because I'm nervous, so I just wanted to be able to have the text. So settle in for a few minutes. I'm sure some of you are thinking that you shouldn't have put a microphone in my hand. At the Rumney board meeting that I attended last week, Woden Teachout asked me what is a very obvious question, which is why do I want to be the chair of the WSU board? And I was a little bit caught off guard by that question, actually, even though it's obvious, because that was the fifth meeting that I attended of the five district boards, and the first time I'd been asked that question. So I answered it at the moment, passively, I think, but I've been thinking about it ever since. And since I didn't speak to this group just now when I was nominated and elected, I'll say some things about it. So first I wanted to touch on Act 46 briefly. And I just want to acknowledge openly what you all already know, which is that my position on Act 46 was that all things being equal, I would prefer consolidation for the supervisory team. And Bill has also made clear that probably would have been his preference as well. So there may be some questions in people's minds as we move forward from Act 46 about whether I wanted to be chair so that I could advance a consolidation agenda behind the scenes or in backhand fashion, or might be wondering whether ideas or issues I raise as chair are intended to hint or suggest that consolidation is better or necessary than what we are doing. So I just want to say unequivocally that I support what ultimately was our collective decision on that issue, truly. I've advocated for it and defended it as actively, ably, and passionately as possible, and will continue to do that to the best of my ability. And I think Bill has also made it clear that he's heard the board as well in respect to the position. So I guess what I'm trying to tell you is I don't have a secret agenda. In fact, after the Act 46 process concluded, it'd be fair to say that I was void of agenda of any kind. I was tired. I didn't feel bad about the outcome, but I did feel worn out by it, honestly. And I was about 90% set not even to run for the board again, and just to kind of slip quietly away from this fine group of people. So I want to tell you about how and why that changed. So last November at a budget meeting for DOTI, I asked Bill and our principal, Matt Young, a series of questions about school costs. I wanted to look beyond budgeting just for one single year because I had a feeling that the Doty board was going to have a conversation with voters in Worcester soon about what it might mean and cost to keep Doty open in various scenarios. So I asked what it would cost for Doty to stay open on a shoestring, what it would cost for Doty to maintain its current level of operations, and what it would cost for Doty to become a high-performing school. So Bill and the leadership team discussed these questions and came back with a considered answer. And the answer was, a little surprisingly, that making Doty a high-performing school is not a matter of money. I'm going to repeat that. Making Doty a high-performing school is not a matter of spending more money. It's not about adding positions or services or technology or equipment. Improving our performance is, put simply, about doing things differently. School learning, which we're all here to support, I hope, is an inherently collaborative activity. Obviously, there's collaboration between teachers and students, but there's also collaboration among students in any given classroom. All of them bring unique, diverse sets of aptitudes, challenges, passions, and knowledge to the classroom every day. The learning of the group as a whole is enriched and enhanced by the extent to which they're able to leverage their collective strength in service to their shared goal of learning. How well is each student activated and inspired to learn, to share their learning? How well do they learn as a group? How many students can each class draw on effectively in this pursuit? How many classes in a single age cohort exist in any given school building? There might be some alchemy to the process of how peers come together in common cause, but we know it when we see it, and it can be inspiring and awesome to behold. We saw it recently as U32 students responded to recent events in Florida and here in Vermont. By the same token, teaching is optimally a collaborative activity. To quote from Bill's letter in December, the most positive strategy we can implement is to have teachers work together on the same student goals and in tandem to learn how to best help their students achieve those goals. In other words, like students, teachers work best when they have the opportunity to work and confer with each other in real time about how best to achieve student outcomes with like groups, to learn from one another, be inspired by one another, leverage their collective strength for the common good. These are only some of the examples of things we can focus on cultivating if we want to improve our schools. My concern for our boards and our schools, as we put Act 46, thankfully, in the rearview mirror, is that having said that we prefer our current governance structure, we'll settle into a sense that our schools are fine just the way they are. That as much as we try to avoid characterizing our AGS proposal as a defense of the status quo, that status quo will become our default operating principle nevertheless. My hope is that we can celebrate what we are while also taking up the challenge of real, concrete ideas for how we can improve, that we can aspire, in Scott's words, to change everything by staying the same. I'm almost done. So over time, thinking about these things and watching the U32 students channel their passion, watching my own sons outclass me on many occasions with their daring and grace on the issues of the day, over time I realized, maybe to my chagrin, that I'm not yet too old or too tired to dare to do great and difficult things. Governance is also a collaborative exercise. We have an opportunity to model superlative collaborative governance together, to leverage the collective strength of our schools and our boards and of all the people in this room in service to a clear and shared vision. If we model collaborative governance in partnership with our instructional leaders, and if we hold ourselves accountable to our shared vision, we can credibly expect more collaboration of our teachers and of our students. And the evidence suggests that this will lead to better educational outcomes. Or similarly with other goals we could adopt, it will lead to better board operations or better skills assessments or better community engagement strategies and outcomes, or all of the above. The first step is daring to express our vision clearly. It can't be skipped. Goals provide clarity. They state what we want to achieve, what we will hold ourselves and the school system to, what we will measure, and how we will know whether or not we succeed. They are touchstones that shape our work on school time, school quality, negotiations, policy, instruction, assessment, facilities, communications, everything that we do. As the chair of this board, my job is simply to facilitate and support this board's vision. That's my only job responsibility. Whatever that vision may be, you may have. So I'm asking you, not just for our students and for our staff, but for my own sake, personally as well, that we have a bold vision of what we can do together in the coming year. I'd love if we can commit to asking hard questions and making hard decisions together and to aspire to improve what we do. If we take up the example of our students, we can also set an example for them in return. I want to be excited and proud when I talk to communities about what we're doing in Washington Central. I want to be excited and proud when I talk to students and to teachers and to principals and to the world about what we're doing in Washington Central. Among all the boards that we could be, I'm asking you to commit to being that board, or if you like, to commit to being those boards together. So I don't have a secret agenda, but I do have an agenda, and that is it. So all that said, having taken all that time, of our precious time, let's see if we can take a small step in that direction. So we do have a time crunch. Act 46 didn't allow us to start our goals conversation last fall or earlier in the year. And so now we find ourselves really with only two carousel meetings left this academic year. And this one is already rapidly slipping away. So with that in mind, I'd like to see if we can keep discussion about the list of goals that we have to the point. Noting that we do have another 2 months, April and May, where we can work together on massaging and tweaking the goal language before they come up for a vote. So we don't need to do everything tonight. Really what we're trying to do is make sure that our list is comprehensive, it's not missing anything, and then we'll go through a process using the patented dot technology to indicate which goals people think are most worthy of being prioritized. So, Bill, do you want to say anything about the list of goals? Or? Okay.
If you want me to,
No, that's fine.
I don't think I have much to add. I think it's a little discussion.
Have people had a chance to review the goals before the meeting? Okay, so then I will not read them now. I'll save that time. So we'll open up for the discussion. Anything anyone wants to comment on, or are there any goals that are missing or that need to be reworded? Yes, Lord.
I'm sorry, we only have one mic tonight, so that's
okay. So I think having said what you just said about all the boards working together at our East Montpelier board meeting, I didn't see it listed. We talked about possibly having a retreat for the entire board together, and Kelly is here today, so she can help explain a little bit about resilience is, but to add that, that's an easy achievable goal. So the idea was that the full board will have a retreat together and we'll watch the movie Resilience, which the entire staff of Washington Central has watched already, so then we can be, you know, working together with the staff in collaboration. So if you could, that's an easy one, so if you could add that to the list, that would be great.
Sure, maybe we can put that under board governance. Okay, thanks, Bill.
Matthew, thanks so much for inspiring us to start us off. I was just going to say, I love this list of goals, and some of them seem very much that they would require us to really lift our eyes and think big and engage in governance work. And some of them, I think, would pull our eyes down. And I think it could be argued that some of them would be better delegated to the administrators, the capable administrators that we hire to do the work. So I guess I'm making a pitch when looking at these to really think about what we can do together and the power that we can have as a board if we stay focused on governance work and trust our administrators to implement the vision that we established.
Yeah, I would just add to that if a goal seems overly broad or vague or undefined, the intent really is to work with the leadership team to flesh these out a little bit and even outline a new implementation plan so that, you know, if we're adopting a goal, we kind of know then what action steps are anticipated or what questions still remain to be asked that we can't answer just yet.
I think it might be worthwhile, particularly in light of current events, that school safety become a goal. And I'm thinking more in terms of board guidance that's provided in the budget process, not so much these doors should be bulletproof or this should be that, but more providing for the schools and administration a framework or a vision or around school safety. So what's our community value? What's our community expectations on the level of safety and how we expect that to be accomplished?
I have two issues. One is, and kind of piggybacks on Stephen's issue of school safety, but it deals with the weather issues that were pretty dramatic this year. I think we ought to revisit and just talk about how we want to deal with weather issues. We had a particularly hard time at Middlesex this year in terms of buses, off the road, what we want envision for equipment, when school should be called, whether it should be called more quickly than it is, and because even though we're a unified district in terms of NSU, it seems like there are significantly different weather patterns depending upon what town you're in. And so that is one area where one side just does not fit all. The second is to, I hope we can get together as a board and talk about resource allocation. Because as much as Matt points out that it may not be more money that will make any of our schools a high flyer, well, achieving school, money and resources help. And we are going toward a unity of interest amongst all of us. We should also back it up by at least if there's a school that is struggling in a particular area in our school, as a supervisory unit, dedicate more resources to that school and to address that issue. And so I would hope that we can develop a mechanism where we can do that and, you know, everyone would fund it. We have an ADM funding mechanism generally, but funded, but with this very specific resource allocation to help a particular school that might need it in a particular area.
Any other comments, thoughts, additions to the list?
All right. Yes. Thanks, Matthew. Along the communication side, you know, one thing I would know this is the appropriate place, but I think given the fact we need to increase communication, not with among boards, this is part of that, but I think any place where we can go out and reach out to other boards as individuals, just attend a meeting, possibly look, even bridging the communities with events that just get people talking. They don't have to be all bad, you know, business. I think that is to our advantage. Communication is so important to making these, you know, kind of a, I mean, that's the good thing about consolidation, if you do it right, where you actually bring communities together. It's worked in other areas, and they're still autonomous, but it's really about relationships. And I think we, as board, we may want to think about that. How do we actually build those relationships that serve that purpose, that intent of what that, the bad word consolidation, what that really means.
Yeah, I think it's a great point. And I'll make a plug for our engaging communities category of goals there. Communication plans for every district, SU as a whole, I think it's important.
So please bear with me if these things are obvious, but when I'm thinking about communication, the notes that I made when I looked at this was trying to figure out how we can each bring what we think or have, specifically I guess our teachers and our administrative staff from our respective schools, bring what they think are the best things that are working in their school. So I guess I'm saying, I'm wondering if maybe you'd be more specific, like trying to, it's like we have six experiments going on. Let's bring the best of those things back to the hub and see if we can use those things in other schools. And maybe that's already happening, so I'm sorry if it is. But I thought that particular kind of communication might be helpful.
So would that be staff communication, collaboration, networking, sharing of ideas?
I guess I was specifically thinking, when you said think big, for instance, one of the things that occurs to me when I think big is, well, what are we missing? What totally new thing can we do? And that mostly comes down to our teachers. That's at the school level. So let's say that there is some school, at Doty, and somebody has done something really that, like, this teacher's like, I'm really excited by the results of this. I think it would be really great if we could encourage that specific person to come and tell us, I think this is working really well, so that the rest of our schools can consider how to implement those excellent strategies that don't actually require any additional capital.
Any other thoughts?
Can I? One more? This actually has to do with Pam and what she was saying earlier. I mean, this is my first time back on the board after many years being off, but it strikes me that we've got a communication problem already on a micro level. This is something we want to work on as boards. We represent the people around us, and I don't know if we have to be answerable, we have to be accountable. We certainly have to have that communication, be it no matter how hard it is or what it involves. And I think that's something we need to probably work on. If when we get feedback like this, that tells me that there's something amiss with us in the way we're responding. We're the connection to the community, the real connection to the community. So I think we need to look down in that micro end a little bit, make sure we're doing this right.
Board communication with parents and
communities. Yeah.
If there are no other burning suggestions, someone can't even sit still, then I think we'll move to our little prioritization exercise. So each of you should have received three colorful stickers. And the idea here, I think most of you will be familiar with it, is that you use your stickers however you like. You can put all three on one goal, I think. You really feel like that's the paramount one. Or you can spread them out as you like. And the idea here is just to get a kind of quick bird's eye sense of what really rises to the top of mind of the group as a whole. So let's take 5 minutes and feel free to peruse the boards and place your stickers.
The board's behind us.
Thank you.
Dana. I'm in a school board meeting.
Bars.
Feels like spring today.
Thanks everybody for the
finally. Yes, so, I'm ready. Everybody's ready.
There are some fairly clear standouts here. So community engagement. I'm not going to count these dots, but I think I can be safe in saying that there's a lot of them. So a discussion about professional development for board members and community engagement in general needs to improve. Over here. Investigating policy governance, which we definitely want to do. I was going to mention beforehand, I forgot that actually there are other models of board governance as well. Policy governance isn't the only one. So maybe we can investigate models of board governance. And then board monitoring, so relating to the school quality committee and how we monitor the effectiveness of our school system. So I would say those are the three easy standouts here. I don't see any others that come close to reaching that level of support. So, is there any objection, any comment, any? I'm looking for consent here. Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. Okay, so next we have 4.2, superintendent evaluation. So, Kari Bradley has kindly agreed to give a presentation.
Oh, no, I'll take care of it. Okay, do we have some slides?
They're coming.
Okay.
It might be hard to see with the sun.
Okay, so just everybody had received the summary of the evaluation in your packet, so hopefully you had a chance to look through that. My goal here is just to provide an overview. I just want to start out by saying it's very unusual in my experience to do this in an open public process. This is basically a personnel activity, and we've normally be done in a very private setting, but kudos to Bill for being open to doing it this way, basically demonstrating his accountability to us, and you know, how important that function is. So it's, let's see. It's been a little over 2 years since we did the last evaluation, so I'm just going to run us through the purpose that we had in mind when we conducted this process was, first of all, to fulfill our contractual relationship responsibility with Bill. Our contract with Bill actually says at least every 2 years, if not every year, we will perform a formal evaluation. Of course, we want to assess his performance and provide feedback and guidance where that's appropriate. Also, I think that this process can help us develop a shared understanding and expectations, since there are seven different entities here and 32 members. I think it's important to spend some time clarifying what is it that we actually expect. Being as clear as we can, we owe that to Bill as our employee. And then hopefully this is a process that ends up strengthening our relationships and building trust. That's up for all of us to decide. So moving on, we used a similar process to what we did 2 years ago. We had the board member survey instrument, and I'm really pleased to report that we received between 78 and 94% response rate. So if you remember how we did this, we sent out each standard, each of the five standards separately, That was done intentionally to provide more time to respond. We'll have to review whether, you know, we think that's the best process or not, because it ended up being highly variable. We got feedback that it was a little confusing. But we did have a much higher response rate this time, so thank you very much for that. We also sent the same survey instrument to the leadership team, got between 50 and 64% response rate from those folks, and then Bill provided the self-evaluation. A little bit about the instrument. So we used, again, a variation of a survey based on the ISLIC standards, which stands for
Interstate Leadership
License Consortium. Did everybody hear that? It's basically objective standards about what's for school leadership and how that's used beyond just RSE. And so there's five standards, and I'm just going to run very quickly through this because it's way too much detail. Standard one is about vision, culture, and instructional leadership. In terms of the overall ratings, 32 of the 34, that includes board and leadership team, rated Bill either highly effective or effective. So very strong result. And Bill gave himself a developing/effective for this standard. Standard two is operations, resource, and personnel management. I believe this was the strongest area in terms of performance. And he gave himself an effective. Strengths that were recognized were budgeting, contract negotiations, and capital planning and facilities. These are themes that I pulled out of the comments. And then a concern and a growth opportunity would be in the area of personnel management, was mentioned several times. Standard three, board governance and policy. Again, the average here overall was in the effective area, and himself was effective. And I just pulled out one quote. One of the art part of summarizing this is looking at all the different quotes and trying to be representative about what goes into the report, but I like this one. Bill works hard to keep all of our boards informed. He presents important outside research as well as information about our schools to guide us in our decisions. He listens to our priorities and works to turn ideas into plans and actions. I thought that was summarized well. Standard four, communication and community relationships. When we did this survey 2 years ago, this was the area where Bill got the lowest scores, and that was true again this year. The board's scores and leadership were somewhere generally between developing and effective. Bill gave himself a developing in this area. We recognize that he's good at understanding the context for in which we operate, and he was recognized multiple times for his efforts to improve in communication, especially around the implementation plan. Folks said that they were wanting improvements to create an atmosphere of trust and respect, and also in the area of group communication. So this is an area where we saw that there's still room for improvement, although I have to say there was recognition that there was good effort and progress in this area. And standard five, ethical leadership. Here, of all the different ratings, 95% of them for board and administrators was highly effective or effective, so very positive. Yep, Bill gave himself development. So, quick summary. So generally, very highly positive. That's what I take from this, especially for standards 1, 2, 3, 5. Overall, effective or better from board and leadership team. Got highest marks for use of data, planning and budgeting, and efforts to close the achievement gap. But there were other many high scores throughout this. So I think we should feel very positive about that. Again, communication and community relationships was identified as the most significant opportunity for improvement. But yet, the overall average ratings range from developing to effective, and developing came from Bill himself. It's higher than the rest of us. So I would say that, you know, that's okay. And so moving on, next steps. So we will work with Bill to define goals. I think we sort of gave some general goals last time coming this process. We weren't very specific. I think we have an opportunity to be more specific, including some way of checking in
between now and the next evaluation, I think would be appropriate. But I guess we'll leave that probably to the executive committee to work on the details of that. We will ask you for your feedback on the evaluation process. For some of us, it was the first time that we've done this particular process. None of us have done it more than twice, so I think we're still learning, and we'd definitely like to improve. One of my personal goals is to write down exactly how we do this so that the next group that conducts this, if we're going to use this process or something similar, has something to start from. And then, thirdly, I'd say we want to continue to develop our monitoring system, which we just identified as one of our priorities. I think that there is value in this type of evaluation process, but I think there's also value in receiving reports like we did last month and also in the fall in response to more specific policies that give us more specific information about what we expect. I think that we will be served by pursuing that style of evaluation as well. Okay, so that's my overview, and let's open it up for questions. Brian, do you have another mic?
Question and a comment. The question is, can you just clarify, there's a range of responses, and just kind of clarify what that means. And then second, notice that it's possible that only 50% of the leadership team participated in it, and it seems like it would be a really valuable aspect of this process, equally if not more valuable than our input in some ways. And so I'm wondering if there's a way that we can make that more, if we can require that, or in some way improve that success rate. Okay.
Great. So the first question was, what did it mean by that range of response rates? And 2 years ago when we did this, we said you had to fill out the whole of it, evaluation, submit it in one fell swoop, so there was only one number, there wasn't a range. This time, if you remember, we sent it out in stages, and this was an idea that with more time, you could do the, it was a fair amount of work to actually look at the evidence and fill this out. And so we thought it would be a good idea to send it out in stages and send with reminders. And what ended up happening was that some people filled out some and not others. We actually got some feedback that people could remember if they filled out this survey, and we didn't have the evaluation set up so that you couldn't fill it out twice, so it's possible that there's some duplication in there. So I think I can safely conclude that that system is not ideal, but there may be some other way. How to improve the response rate from the leadership team? I think that's a good question. I think there are probably ways. I will say that 2 years ago, the response rate from us was 50%. So there's clearly ways to get better at it. And I don't have a great response, but worth working on. Other questions or comments?
Although it might have been confusing to have it done in parts, being able to discuss it at the board level in parts made it doable because it wasn't such a huge discussion. And I think we were able to get into more depth in each area because we only focused on two at a time. So I think that was very positive.
Good. I can't remember if I said, but we're going to take your feedback on the process of a survey. Survey Monkey will go out in the next week or so.
Yeah, that's what I
very brief.
It's not my email, but we'll get it out next week.
Very, very brief, but just if, you know, while it's still somewhat fresh in your mind, if you can give us your feedback so we can put that possibility. Anything else? Scott.
Even though the numbers are very handy, I know for myself, I may have spent a tenth of a second on each number evaluation, but a fair amount of time and care on the narrative part. Just want to make sure that Bill actually sees all those comments, all those narrative comments, and also that somehow the narratives, if there's ever any question regarding the evaluation, the narratives actually are given their due weight.
Thank you for that feedback. Yeah, it's important. Anything else?
especially like to thank Kari in particular, and also Caroline May for their special work on the evaluation, and of course Bill for his open and careful participation. So I think we have local board meetings warned for 7.
Yes, we do that just as a general.
Sure.
For, I think all but maybe, I know it's definitely Romney and Eastmont, but they might have one other agenda if everyone has just a single agenda. Okay.
So what I'm going to suggest is that we pass on 4.3 now, and we do the reports to the board and the action agenda, and then we'll come back to 4.3, since that is the thing that when we break up, the local boards will be at least one of them. So reports to the board, the executive committee, I'm guessing probably would be my responsibility to do that at this point, but I'm very unprepared. So is there anybody else on the executive committee who can share?
I think we can say that the minutes from the last meeting were in the packet. If there's any questions.
The minutes of the last meeting were sent out separately in the packet. So people should have them, yes. Financial reports.
Yes.
Those are those financial reports were given to you all in local meetings. So in this carousel, we didn't add a second set of those. So you had them because we had both.
Policy committee.
We didn't have a meeting since our last one.
Okay. School start time.
So we had our forum on Monday evening, and it went really well. Those committee, we have a lot of new committee members too, which is awesome. And we had a great turnout, I thought. What do we have, 22 people? And then the people that are involved in the committee. Great discussion. People brought up a lot of points and a lot of information. There was a lot of consensus about the value of looking at how our students learn the best, what times of day, and that there is real science here. But then all of the trickle down, what we need to know. And we're gonna have another one on the 11th. So I will send out another flyer for that one. So please distribute it, put it up at the school, send it out to everybody you know so that we can get more. The next one, we're gonna come together and discuss some of those. Well, what would the parts be? How would this look? Where are the priorities for the times of day? So it'll be good to do. It was for community engagement. It was very, I was impressed. We are going to, as a committee, take what we've done at the first forum, the second forum, come together and make a report for the full board. That's what we're going to do.
Right. Yes. And then that would then go on an action list.
Then the board can decide, yes.
So whether to go on.
Whether to take action.
So people are telling the community members, they can say, this is happening, we are presenting on the 6th, so we have things to say for that.
Ideally, they're in the forum.
I would want to advise the board to be careful on that, Allison. I want to encourage people to come. That's not what I want to be careful about. But the timeline's that tight that June 6th, there will be a decision made by the Washington Central Board. I believe from the charge and the discussion we've had in other meetings, and please, anyone correct me if I'm wrong, if I've got this recollection wrong, that the school start time was charged to bring back findings, recommendations, or continued work. I think at that point, I don't think we'll be at a point to say this is exactly where we're going for a year away, because I know there'll be my opinion is probably the best way to say it, is that there's going to be a lot of things to figure out. I think we're going to have some, I hope by then we'll have some direction and kind of a feeling of a sense of where the community is. But I don't think to be able to say these are all the details and everything's going to be there. And I would, Karen.
There's one key thing that sounds like we're going from April 11th to June. We're not. April 23rd, the committee's going to get together and develop the survey. They're going to get out to the community and send that out May 14th to 28th. So we're going to have a 2-week window in May of just trying to get as much feedback from the community. So individual community members with concerns, with questions, ideally that's going to be captured in the survey, and then in order to do a presentation, we're going to take the survey, the forums, put that together. So there's definitely more room for community contribution.
Well, and all of this is on the website. There's a specific page for the School Start Committee stuff. All the studies that we've looked at, all the dates of our timeline, the minutes of the meetings, so it's all there too.
Thanks, Karen. The SBA.
Everybody, you should have got an update. I'm not going to take too much time because we have the other meeting, but an update came in this afternoon from you, so the SBA. If you have any questions, let me know. It came in around 5:30. The only bill, I'm going to sound really reductive, but I felt like I kind of wasted the retreat there for Western Resilience. So if you look at this update, also see that the Senate has approved a bill to deal with child trauma and toxic stress. And it's something that we're involved as statewide. We're involved as Washington Central staff has done that. So I didn't want to just, you know, let it die. Maybe you guys can continue to talk about this at your local board meetings. But it's something that is it is important to recognize right now. And the last thing, we got, everybody knows, we've been talking about this as the SBA Board 2, the secretary is effective, gone as of April 1st, which is really short notice. The governor has met with the deputies. We won't know for sure who is, but it's more than likely that it's just going to stay with them, so there's no panic that it's going to stay with them. The two deputies right now at the agency, we don't know that for sure, but the interim should be somebody that is related with what's going on right now.
So I'd ask you to look at a board. I know all of you take careful read of your own school that you're a board member of. I invite you all to look at another school. There's many great celebrations in those reports, whether it's Sugaring at Romney, or I saw some things from Cal's about Warrior Wellness. So take a minute, look at that. There's some great activities that the principals put together of what's going on in the school system, and there's a lot in there about reading the report.
Okay, on to the action agenda. 6.1 is to approve the second reading of transportation policy, the grade advancement policy, responsible computer network internet use policy, and the class size policy, which start on page 29. We've seen these before. Was there any need to keep them
these? The policies, we saw them at the last one, and then we haven't had another.
And are we actually adopting these on a second reading?
Yes.
Okay. Are there any questions or comments about the policies? Yes.
I was just looking at grade advancement, retention, promotion, and acceleration of students. And I guess I just want confirmation that the proficiency-based learning is been thought about in terms of acceleration, promotion, and retention. I think that's a huge, they're kind of at odds with each other. And I don't want an answer, I just want to know that people are thinking about it.
Yes, people are definitely thinking about it.
Was it?
We don't have an answer.
Yeah, it's a pretty big thing.
Use policy and G16 class size policy, and submit by the same time.
Aye.
Opposed? Six point two is to approve the WCSU 2018-2019 school year calendar, which is on page 35.
The only thing I would say is that it's in alignment with the Central Vermont Career Center as required in statute for 175 days. We don't have everything. We meet 178 of those days in alignment. We have two that are not. Questions or comments about the calendar? Yes.
I hope I'm remembering correctly that in the executive committee, maybe there was some talk about future changes to the calendar, and I'm wondering if there's anything you can preview for us about that.
I can't preview future changes, but I can say this, Johnny. That the effort that we're making with school start time will be equal or more than we need to engage the community to change the calendar. Watching my colleagues down in Chittenden County a couple years ago really try to go with a calendar that's best for learning, where there were quarters in the year with a week to 2 week gaps in between for both acceleration and remediation and intervention, and for teacher collaborative work time, there wasn't the community work to the level they thought they needed to do. We have a lot of folks that are still running the year based on an agrarian calendar, which is what this is. I think it's critical to move the proficiency-based learning forward that we recalendar. I know I feel safely saying this in a public setting for my other four superintendent colleagues, that we have to come to agreement. I know they want to change it. We don't know how to move that community to a place where that's okay to do, and where it's better for kids, it's better for the teachers. It's part of what Chris brought up this winter safety, and I talked about this. That's part of the issue right there. So it's being able to say we can change, and I think that's even more than school start time.
Thank you. Phil? So what you're saying, the change that you're foreseeing is one like you just described with the 2 weeks?
Or something different, Corinne. I don't want to say that mine is the way to do it, but I would say that to change the calendar from where we are to something different, a day or two here and there is not a big deal, but to move the patterns that are there will take a huge community engagement effort, because we're talking about many different aspects that people traditionally set up their life. I have no other way of saying it. You know, it's everything they do, not just school. And there's a whole economy behind that.
Would anyone like to move that we approve the WCSU 2018-2019 school year calendar?
Second.
Is there a second? Second. Okay. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? And 6.3, to authorize the supervisory union to accept all federal and state grants, to administer and act as the representative of all member school districts of the UCSU.
Our auditor was here last meeting in February, talked about authorizing the superintendent for two things, one for grants, which you've been doing, and two as a signatory, which we'll do in June, is that this is one of those two pieces that's needed so we can administer the grants as required under state statute. There's on page 3, I believe it is, on the annotated agenda, there's a suggested motion.
Someone has that.
Matthew, I would move that we administer supervisory union to accept all federal and school grants, to administer and to act as a representative of all member school districts of Washington Central Supervisory Union.
Thank you. I would just offer a friendly amendment that the first word be authorize.
Oh, authorize.
All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? All right, thank you. Okay, so let's go back to 4.3, Act 46. I would like Act 46 not to be on my agenda, but it is. It's persistent. Gotta give it that. So, following the hearing, or the meeting, I guess, that we had with AOE on March 8th, I walked away from that meeting feeling like we had not really given good answers to the questions about our efficiency study and our special education study. And after conferring with Bill and with Scott and with Ford, we decided that it would be appropriate for us to provide some additional information on those questions. Working with Bill, drafted this piece that is included in your packet. It's basically just two pages of narrative about the reports and kind of what's in them, and then a report on the recommendations and what the status of each is. We tried to keep it fairly cut and dried and not make grandiose statements or conclusions, but really just in an effort to provide them with the information as part of our due diligence. So we'd like to ask that the district boards possibly meet to consider endorsing sending this to the Secretary of Education. We didn't feel like we had the authority to do that without your approval to communicate new information and content to her. If the boards do that tonight, we can send it tomorrow, and it will actually be received by the current secretary, or whatever that's worth. So are there any questions or comments or thoughts about that? There's no action required by this body now, but by, rather by the six boards after we adjourn. Okay. I hear no questions or comments. So I'm going to assume that everyone is okay to consider this at their district meetings. All right. And we'll get to talk a little bit about process and where people can meet in a second. Just want to go to 7.0, future agenda items. Are there any future agenda items? I have a couple. I'd like to put an item on our next agenda for readopting our norms. The norms are on page 2 of the packet. As I was preparing the report to Act 46, I noticed that one of the recommendations of the efficiency study was that we re-vote on our norms every year. So why not? Let's do that. So it'd be good to review them and vote on those. A second agenda item I'd like to put on is a discussion item about policies and the extent to which they should be uniform across the SU, and if there is any reason for policies to be different across the SU, what are those cases? So basically to discuss policy work. As far as the retreat, is it okay if the executive committee maybe works with the retreat, or maybe you can even schedule a retreat? I think if you invited everyone, we could use it as a warrant meeting. I'm just trying to think of ways to, as an SU board, we can't talk about it again until June, so.
Yeah, that'd be great if maybe Bill can share at our meeting that it would be good for the retreat, would be a great day. That's part. Can you share that, Bill, your idea of bringing the consultant that is working with the staff?
We'll talk, yeah, I can share that. Where Flora was going, that problem is more on social emotion, expand to social emotion.
Okay, 8.0 and 9.0, let's do those together, board comments and board communication. Anything else to add there? Looks like not. So right before we adjourn, let me ask Bill to give some details about where meeting's gonna happen.
I
just quickly looked through the agenda. There's a couple of boards that only have the one item for AOB, so if you want to stay in here, quickly convene, vote to either accept, you know, to approve that report to go or not. You could do that and someone take minutes and get those to Krista. A couple, I think there's two or three boards that have another item, and your rooms are posted on your agenda. If you feel more comfortable in your room, that's fine too. It's just really trying to track those minutes and make sure we get that those get handed into Krista. And I think that's about it. Thanks, everyone. So we'll adjourn at 7:00.